Economics of Love
Good morning, everyone, and welcome back to the 17th episode of Economics of Love with Dr. Kwalithai Bunyasena, and you can call me Gukik. This program is broadcasting from Ratchamongkol University of Technology, Pranakon. We see each other every Thursday from 9 to 9:30 a.m. First of all, I would like to say thank you for spending us your time to listen to our love story and Academics Daily of Love. We hope that you will be inspired to love others, including yourself, with happiness. Today, we are going to talk on the topic Finding Mr. Right from Catherine Hutchinson Hayes. She held up the bare finger, the one that had once boosted a gorgeous diamond ring, divorced it. For the second time, Catherine was a woman of accomplishment, a school principal, mother to two beautiful girls. Yet, she was a magnet for men who were not what they seemed. Why couldn't she get married, right? Were to love story even real? She how a simple message sent to Catherine's spirit brought her to Mr. Right. For me, it's not easy to find the right guy, and I believe many women still have this problem too. So today, we might find the way to find the right guy from Catherine's story.
Economics of Love.
Welcome to the first part of Economics of Love. Today, we are going to talk about the story of Catherine Hutchinson Hay. After two failed marriages, this mother of two children decided to have faith that she would bring her the right partner. She talked to herself that, "I pull myself onto the bathroom counter so I could see my face in the mirror close up. Red rimmed eyes, runny nose, cheek stained with mascara. The next time you get to thinking you want a man in your life, I told myself, remember this, remember how miserable you are." She held off her bare finger, the one that had once boosted a gorgeous diamond ring, divorced it. For the second time, she was a woman of accomplishment, a school principal, mother to two beautiful girls. Yet, she was a magnet of men who were not what they seemed. Why couldn't she get married, right? You might have this question the same as me. She wrote that morning, my lawyer had called to tell me my divorce was finalized. I had known it was coming, but the emotion that boiled up surprised me. Anger, shame, confusion. I didn't want the girls to see me like this. I dropped them off at my sister's house. Then I retreated to my bedroom and proceeded to have an epic pity party. "God, do you even love me?" I checked out. "How could you let this happen to me again? Don't you care about my children? Our happiness?" I would grown up in New York City, rises by strict parents of Jamaican and Portuguese descent. They instilled in my four siblings and me the importance of using our God-given abilities to succeed in life. My mother was a nurse with a side business as a cake baker and designer. My father owned a construction company and used his basement barbershop to minister to young men when kids were expected to be just as driven. I pushed myself to excel in everything I did: academics, piano, art, marriages. A family were scared. Divorce was something spoken of only in whispers. In college, I fell in love with literature and writing. I earned a master's degree in education and got hired to teach 6th grade for school district on Long Island. On top of teaching art at an university school, I often got assigned the kids the other teachers had given up on, the problem students, but I discovered I had a talent for keeping them engaged, motivated. I mentored several students outside the classroom and got involved in citywide programs. That's how I met husband number one. He worked for the New York City Mayor's Office. Smart, motivated. Of course, he is handsome. And he had Caribbean roots like mine. That confirmed he was the one. I didn't even have to pray on it. We married. Then I discovered how little we actually had in common, like the fact that he was a smoker and didn't exercise. Why I love inline skating? We were opposites in our approach to handling finances and emotions. He had zero interest in praying or reading the Bible together. Our first year of marriage, I got pregnant and gave birth to a baby girl we named Saji. However, parenthood didn't bring us any closer. We divorced a year later. My parents were supportive, but there was no hiding their disappointment. I threw myself into my work and made plans to pursue a doctorate. Recruited by Arizona State for an intensive program. Meanwhile, I mentored new teachers in New York City. That's how I met husband number two. I knew the pitfalls to look out for by then. He was regimented, financially responsible, raised in the church, and the way he folded laundry made me melt. He is amazing. I gushed to God one night. I wasn't asking for confirmation actually, but it sure felt right. I got accepted into the USU program. Little of us realized how demanding the program would be. I got pregnant and had our daughter, Kizia. Rising two children added to the strain. I graduated and found a job as an assistant principal at a school an hour from our home. Saji cried every day when I left for work. In time, I learned that my husband and I had different ideas about parenting and discipline. We stayed together for 5 years, but in the end, it was clear we couldn't go on. That's how I ended up with a second failed marriage. Unfortunately, today because of time limitation, we have to continue her love story next week. Don't miss it. You might find something surprising.
Economics of Love.
Welcome back to the second part of Economics of Love. Today we are going to talk about 5 ways to tell that you have really found the right partner. From APU Edomer, LMFT, TS A Couple's Trip. When dating someone new, the feeling you experience as you get to know each other can be incredibly exciting. And once you are off of the honeymoon phase, the next stage of your relationship can be just as rewarding. The time to build a deeper bond grounded in trust and genuine love. But even when genuine love is there, it's understandable to have some worry about the future. Is this person the right one? Have I found the right partner? Why they can be a little unnerving? Questions like this are perfectly normal, especially if you have already experienced a loss of a previous relationship. Here are 5 key markers that can help you decide if you are with your lifelong mate. 1. You share the same or complementary values. 2 people don't have to look at the world in the exact same way or hold the exact same beliefs in order to have a healthy relationship together, but their basic values, the concepts and things that reflect what matters most to an individual, at least need to be compatible in order for a relationship to work long term. One of the most obvious examples of how value dictates whether you have found the right partner in the value of raising a family. If 2 partners disagree about whether to have children, they likely aren't a good fit. Other values that often need to be aligned between 2 people include where to live, how to handle finances, the beliefs about privacy and physical health. Above all, couples should understand that their relationship, as well as themselves as individuals, is a fruit work in progress. Who you are when you first got together, and who you will become 10 years down the line will look incredibly different. Values are highly personal and can change over time. How you communicate along the way and stay aligned with these life changes is critical for lifelong success. It's good to talk early and often your partner about your values to make sure they are compatible and that both of your needs are being heard and honored. 2. You handle conflict respectfully and constructively. Conflict in a relationship isn't necessarily a sign that your relationship is troubled. Instead, the way you approach conflicts is an important sign as to whether your relationship will stand the test of time. Couples who enjoy long-term, healthy relationships are able to have issues, even major ones, without resorting the name-calling, put-downs, insults, and excessive criticism. They apologize when necessary and find ways to resolve an issue, reconnect, and move on. If you feel safe, listened to, respected, and loved in your relationship, in and after an argument, you have probably found a good match. 3. You accept them for who they are and vice versa. If you are with the right person, you don't have to change who you are in order for them to love you. And you don't demand your partner to change who they are either. This doesn't mean neither one of you will ever change or that you will never do things that other person doesn't like. But when you are with the right person, your relationship feels like a container that naturally inspires your both to learn and grow. This helps you become more authentic versions of yourselves as time goes on. We're gonna continue number 4 and 5 next week, so don't miss it.
Economics of Love.
Welcome back to Economics of Love. Let's talk about RMUTP news. ราชมงคล University of Technology พระนคร signed a Memorandum of Understanding on Cooperation with the Student Activity Network of 9 institutions to develop the quality of graduates. On the 20th of October 2023, Assistant Professor Sattha Rueang Thenkhae, Assistant President of the University for Student Affairs, along with Ms. Mallika Veerasai, Acting Director of the Student Development Division, and the team to promote student potential and discipline attended the ceremony and signed the Memorandum of Understanding. Student Activity Network of 9 institutions to develop quality of graduates between Rajmongkon University of Technology Pranakon, Suan Sunantha Rajapat University, King Mongkut University of Technology North Bangkok, Sri Savarin Thira Institute of Nursing, Thai Red Cross Society, Civil Activation Training Center, Maritime Training Center, Siam University, Hua Chiao Chaleum Phakiet University, Phumiphol Adunyadet Institute of Technology at the Civil Aviation Training Center, Bangkok. Ms. Pakhanat Makchoy, Governor of the Civil Aviation Training Center and executives of 9 institutions, also signed Student Club President. The Student Club President of the Student Organization, Student Can Learn, a group of students with parents and ministers of the Office of the Basic Education Commission come to witness this signing. Wow, this is good news for our students and also our society in Bangkok. And if you are members of our 9 institutions, please join with us. Before saying goodbye, I would like to say thank you for the information from this website, guysport.org, psychologytoday.com, and rmutp.ac.th. To know more about love, we are going to see each other on every Thursday at 9 to 9:30 a.m. at englishonline.rmutp.ac.th and worldwideweb.youtube.com/@rmutplive8792. Thank you. See you again next week. Bye-bye. สวัสดีค่ะ. Thank you.
Economics of Love